warm welcome to all of you. Thanks for coming on this sleepy Friday afternoon. We're looking forward really to a very interesting talk, and it gives me great pleasure to be able to introduce the speaker today. M.N. Krish is an alumnus of this institute, and he got his B.Tech in civil engineering in 95. He's an expert in data science and predictive analytics, who spent much of his life teasing stories out of numbers to do anything from scheduling planes to selling insurance, of course not simultaneously. He's turned into a novelist with the launch of his offbeat thriller, The Steradian Trail, book zero of the infinity cycle, which has been getting rave reviews since release. Krish also has dual MS degrees from MIT and is back in India after a very long time abroad and is getting his feet wet in the startup scene. He has a web address you can reach him at, and I forgot to mention that Krish and I go back a long way. We're actually classmates from all those years ago when dinosaurs roamed Bourne Avenue. Also, I'm very happy to be doing this introduction today because I gave myself the homework of reading his book. I said I have to do this before I stand up and talk to a bunch of very interested students over here. And it's a really great book. It's absolutely, it's from the thriller genre, and it's thrilling in every page. I had a great time reading the book, and I'm really looking forward to hearing what Krish has to say. He's promised us that he's going to present a few ideas and stories and discuss the running theme of the thriller that he's written. But I also hope that he'll have a few things to say about his journey as a storyteller, because I, for one, am interested in that. So without further ado, I'll hand the mic over to Krish. And he will be speaking for 40 to 45 minutes, at the end of which he'll be more than happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Preeti, for the nice introduction, firstly. And thank you, Suresh, for arranging this. Thank you, OAA, for setting this talk up. And thanks to Professor Nagarajan. He could not be here today, but he has been very helpful in getting this talk arranged. So, and thank you all for coming. I know it's a Friday evening, it's a very lazy Friday evening after elections here. So thank you all for coming, for making the time. Okay. So I'm very happy to be here, back on the campus after a very long time. So very happy. I was also a little bit scared when I walked in into this building, into this ICSR building. I was a little bit scared. There were butterflies in my stomach, right? And I could clearly feel something, you know, because I'm coming to this place after almost 20 years, to this area. The ICSR building did not exist when we were students, okay? When we joined as students. It came up when we were students. We were studying civil engineering, okay? And we are actually practically seeing this place come from the ground up. Our professor used to bring us here to the construction site when we are studying as part of the course and take us around. And each time we had to come and we go back, we had a big, mighty, nasty assignment to do. So when I walked in, I was pretty scared that he was going to pounce on me and ask me to for my assignment this time. So I was just looking around warily, but I don't have any assignment. But this is a place, good place to learn things, you know, because this is the place we used to walk around when all those props and, you know, scaffolding and shoring and all that. I studied civil, so just used to walk around the place here on the roof, you know, I remember walking around. And this is a place where we learn a lot. We learn where you learn actually all the theories and concepts and ideas that you study in BSP. They get thrown out of the window here. You just sit and watch how the people mix concrete. They pour bucket after bucket of water into the mix as if they are making like sambar in the mess. You get pretty scared. But luckily, we engineers have a great gift from God. It's called factor of safety, right? So it took care of everything, and very happy to see this building in top shape even after 20 years. So I'm very happy and pleased about that. And I'm even more happy and pleased I don't have to do an assignment on this building again. Okay? So on that happy note, what I'd like to do is sort of tell you a little bit about myself. I'm I studied civil here and did my master's in OR along with the master's in transportation, and I work in the area of predictive analytics and data mining, data science and all that. But I'm not here to talk about that. So you can sit back and relax. I'm here wearing the hat of a novelist and a storyteller. So I'm going to be telling you some stories drawn from the world of ideas and drawn from the crazy world of ideas, as they call them. Now, once you listen to some of the stories, you'll probably agree with me that that is really crazy out there in the world of ideas. And we can see, right? And ideas, people behind ideas, stories behind ideas hold a great fascination for me. I have no idea why, okay? But they really do, really hold. They grab me by the collar and hold me in their thrall like nothing else. So I just want to share some of that fascination with you through these stories. And these stories may have a moral, may not have a moral. They may have a learning, I don't know. They may have some takeaways, or I see some takeaways, I'll share them with you as well. You can agree with me, you can disagree with me, or you may draw your own conclusions on those stories. And we can discuss all that, quarrel about it in the Q&A session later on. Okay? So with that, I would like to move on, I jump into my first story. But before I go into the first story, let me ask you a silly question. You'll be asking some silly questions. Okay? Any of you here were named after a writer? Any of your parents name any of you after a writer? By show of hands? Okay, one. Excellent. Okay, I really need to come and find out who that writer is, if I could. Okay, it's a character in a novel. Okay, excellent. Could you, do you mind telling me your name and which novel? Shankar. And okay, so we have somebody very close enough to being named after a writer. So very good. It's named after a character. Okay, anybody else? Okay, anyone old enough to be a parent have a kid named after a writer? Anyone old enough to be a grandparent have grandkids named after a writer? Okay, I don't blame you guys. So writing is a crazy thing to do, so I don't blame you guys. But this parents, thank you, Mr. Shankar. You come very close, but no, close but no cigar, as they say. Okay. The parents I'm going to talk about, the Americans, tend to be crazy, right? These crazy parents, they had a baby boy, and they named him after a writer, George Bernard. They named him George Bernard Shaw. Okay, named after George Bernard Shaw, so named their baby boy as George Bernard because they wanted George, little George, to grow up and then become a writer. Okay, unfortunately, little George had his own plans. He had plans of his own. He did not become a writer. He was even wackier than his parents. What did he become? Anyone wants to guess? George Bernard. He became a mathematician. Okay, and a pretty good one at that. Okay. George became a mathematician, and he got himself, when he grew up, he got himself enrolled at a little school, UC Berkeley. Okay? And he was studying mathematics. George was studying mathematics at Berkeley, and he was taking this class from a professor called Jesse Neyman. And every day he will go to this lecture. He's joined for a PhD program, so he has done his bachelor's and master's doing his PhD. And he was taking this course with Jesse Neyman, and he used to go for his class. Each time the professor will have a lecture, will have a class, and at the end, he would write the homework assignments for the day, and they will break. So one day, George was very late for the class, and by the time it was more than halfway through, near the end, and the professor, as usual, had written a couple of problems on the board. So George has no clue what happened in the class before. He sees two problems. Homeworks, writes them down in his notebook, goes back home. And days pass by, he has to submit the homework. He starts working on them, but they turn out to be a lot more difficult than the typical homework assignments he was used to doing. So what does he do? But George is a pretty decent mathematician, right? So, and he keeps working on it. And after a few days' time, he solves those two problems. And then he goes rushing to his professor's office. well beyond the usual deadline, and he sees his professor, again, professor sitting behind his desk. In those days, there were no computers, so the professor is sitting like in the middle of a mountain of papers, and George apologizes for being so late in the submission, and asks the professor, will you accept my assignment? So the professor says, okay, just throw it on the table and go home. So he just leaves it on the table and goes home. A few days pass, okay, and it's a Sunday morning, almost about 8 o'clock, and George is asleep, isn't woken up yet, just still sleeping, and hears a loud banging on the door. He wakes up a bit groggily, grumpily, and then opens the door, and what does he see? His professor standing all excited and animated with a bunch of papers. And he says, hey, I just wrote the introduction to your paper. Why don't you take a look? We'll get it sent out right away. And George looks, what paper? Then the professor has to tell him, the two problems that he solved, right, thinking they're homework assignments, they were the two unsolved and outstanding problems in statistics which no one had solved till then. So he just assumed their homework assignment, just went home, solved them and submitted. Okay? And this George Bernard is none other than George Bernard Danzig, who later became the father of linear programming. Anyone used to linear programming? Yes, simplex method, that was his. Okay? This was George Danzig. And this is this story of George Danzig, right? It is now part of urban legend. Right? And it has been cycled and recycled in so many different forms. It has even taken place in some of the movies, right? Good Will Hunting, right? I think there is an episode based on it. It was lifted straight out of George Danzig's life. And it became an urban legend partly because the story was taken up by the church to basically preach about the power of positive thinking. Okay? So if George had known that these were two big problems that big guys have not been able to solve, he may not have even attempted solving them. But he had no idea. So he just went ahead naively and solved them. So this, again, it's a story that people say, give an instance of power of positive thinking. The church adopted the story and then it became, you know, today it went viral, right? At those days, it became an urban legend. And this is 2014, right? And this is George Danzig's centenary year. So I just wanted to pay my own little homage to him. I'm an OR person. And I revere George Danzig. I wanted to pay my own little homage to him in this talk. Okay. So now I move on to another person who is kind of like Danzig. Okay. Let me take a sip of water if you will. His name is Cliff. Let's just call him Cliff for now. Okay. Even he is a mathematician. Okay. I was pretty good under that. Okay. He represented his country in the International Maths Olympiad. He won the silver medal. And then he went to the university, studied mathematics, got his bachelor's, then enrolled himself for the master's or PhD program, went through the program for a couple of years, then he decided he didn't want to continue further in academia. He wanted to get out and start working. So he quit quit grad school basically and got out and started working. He was maybe about 22, 23 years old, very young, like all of you, and then he started working at an organization where his skills were, as a mathematician, were needed. So he joined this organization. He's still, you know, still a greenhorn, but a bright-eyed, bushy-tailed guy. So he's put under the care of a mentor who basically initiated him and oriented him to the workings of the organization. So he spends 6 weeks in the organization, and his boss basically tells him, gets him used to the place, tells him about the work that goes on every day, fill him in with a little bit of information about the organization and what people are working on. About 6 weeks later, what his boss did one morning was just tell him, okay, this is what we have been doing. And he was telling him about one particular problem they were having. One of the issues they were dealing with was data security or information security, and one of the big guys in the organization had come up with an idea for non-secret cryptography, what do you call today as public key cryptography, right? So he said, he has come up with this new idea, and we now need to find a one-way function in mathematics. Mathematics, you have some function. You need to find a one-way function to make this idea work. And then they break. And this guy, Cliff, goes back to his desk, has his lunch, goes back to his desk and says, okay, my boss said, oh, we need to find this one-way function. And it starts working, takes out a piece of paper and starts working on the one-way function. Within 30 minutes, he's a mathematician, right? And 30 minutes, he comes up with a one-way function and goes and puts it on the table of his boss. Oh, the boss looks at it. How long did it take for you? 30 minutes. He looks through, evaluates, and sees that young club is right. You know, there are no loopholes in the method. The one-way function works perfectly. And then he tells, we guys have been breaking our head over it for 3+ years. Right? All big mathematicians, even with those with PhDs in the organization, they couldn't come up with this stuff. And Cliff didn't know that. He just thought, oh, the boss has given an assignment. I have to solve it. He just solves it and drops it on the table of his boss. So the boss, what does he do? He takes and he writes to his seniors in the organization that, hey, we have developed this new report. He has come up with this one-way function which makes public key cryptography or non-secret encryption. It makes it work. He writes a report, explains a method, and forwards it to his boss. His boss forwards to his boss. And what happens? Young Cliff is at his desk. A few days later, he sees a lot of really strange people walking by to his desk. Very senior guys congratulating him for his achievement. He's pretty happy, right? 22-year-old, 23-year-old, solved a big problem that nobody could solve for 3 years. He does it in 30 minutes. He feels pretty happy about himself. Okay? Now let's freeze right there. Cliff sitting behind his desk, right, taking in all the congratulations, all the messages. Now zoom out to the future, to the year 2006. Okay? 2006 was a very eventful year in the tech world. One of the things, a big news items, was an acquisition of a data security company, okay? EMC Corporation, right? Many of you have heard of it, right? It's a data storage company. They acquired a data security company for about $2.1 billion, okay? That's a B, big B, $2.1 billion. It's a big news. Anyone wants to take a guess how much of that anyone wants to guess how much the data security company had to do with our young Cliff's discovery? A lot, right? If not pretty much everything, okay? A lot. And you want to guess how much of that 2.1 billion went to Cliff? You want to guess? A big fat zero, okay? And do you want to guess how much Cliff's boss or Cliff's organization made out of the 2.1 billion? An even bigger, fatter zero, okay? You want to know why? You want to know why? Cut right there and move to the east coast of the US, to the northeast, to the city of Boston. There are three guys in Boston, three academics. Okay, let's call them Ron, A.D. and Leo. Okay, Ron, A.D. and Leo. Three guys in Boston who are working on the exact same problem as Cliff. Okay, they're working on the exact same one-way function as Cliff. They were cracking their heads at it for one full year. Okay. There, Ron is the computer science whiz, he's a prof, and the AD and Leo, they're researchers, and Leo is a mathematician, okay? And each time they come up with something, Leo shoots them down. Oh, this maths doesn't work, there's something, some problem here. So every function they come up with, they always end up running into some trouble or the other, okay? One full year passes by with no results. And then there comes a holiday. No, there's a holiday, it's called Passover, it's a Jewish religious festival. And these three guys are Jewish guys, they have a get-together at a student's place. In Passover, people drink wine, okay? And these three guys go have a good time, drink wine, go back home, okay? And out of the three, Ron goes back to his house, late in the night, and he's pretty drunk on wine, he's not able to fall asleep. He's feeling very, very bored. Remember, he's a maths prof, or math prof. What do these profs do when they feel very bored, they cannot fall asleep, they are drunk, they read a textbook. So he picked up a maths textbook, started flipping through the pages. And before long, as he's flipping through the pages, something strikes him. And he pulls out his paper, starts working. And by daylight, he has solved the problem that Cliff had solved. He hit upon the same method that Cliff had hit upon. Okay? He figured out the one-way function. In the morning, he goes back to the office, calls up these other two collaborators, right, AD and Leo, and they say, hey, I think we may have something after a year, we may have something now. And these two guys come try to take the idea apart, doesn't come apart, it holds still. They then figure out that they have a solution to the problem. And what do? They have the one-way function. What do? These three guys, remember, are in the US, in Boston. One, academics, they write a paper. Two, they file a patent. Get a patent. Three, they start up a company. Okay? And they start up a company. Just the name of the company is RSA. Right? Rivest, Shamir, Edelman. The three guys. Ron Rivest, A.D. Shamir, and Leonard Edelman. So now the name is familiar, right? And the function they have come up with is the famous RSA encryption algorithm. Okay? And they start up a company based on that. And that was a company that ended up getting bought by EMC. And when did these guys come up with the algorithm? In 1979, 3 years after Cliff had discovered the same thing. And now I can tell you Cliff's full name. It's Clifford Cox, okay? And where was he? He was in the UK. Where was he working? Working for the government, okay? And he was working in a department called the Government Communication Headquarters, okay? This was the department he worked in when he made the discovery, GCHQ. And what were they doing? They were about communication. They were about military communication. They were listening in, phone taps, all that. And they were about sending coded messages to their soldiers. They were in that area. What happened to Cliff's algorithm, which he submitted to his boss and his boss's boss and so on? They saw that this guy had really solved the problem. But at that time, in the 70s, they could not see the digital revolution, the computer revolution that was going to take over. Right, that is in the offing. So what did they do? But they could also see that if fallen into the wrong hands, this could spell trouble. So what did they do? They stamped top secret on Cliff's algorithm, filed it away. Nothing much happened after that. So it's quite ironical, you know, it's again, fits well with the British irony, right? It's a communication department, they hushed the whole thing up. And that was pretty much the end of it. And on the other side of the Atlantic, there were these Americans taking the thing to the whole nine yards. And nobody knew. To everyone, RSA, they were the pioneers of this algorithm. Whereas Cliff, 22 years old, had done this 3 years ahead of them. And he could not even take credit for it for a very long time because his lips were sealed. His department barred him from even speaking about his work, speaking about what he had accomplished. It was much, much later in 2006 when Clifford Cox was actually allowed to go out and speak, tell the world what he had actually done. And now the history of cryptography is getting rewritten and Cliff is getting at least his due, though not, of course, $2.1 billion, right? So I have my own little learning on this, right? Time and place plays a very big role in the world of ideas, right? Cliff was at the wrong time at the wrong place. Whereas these three guys in Boston, they got everything right. They were not in the government. They're working at a university in the private sector, and they had all the freedom to take their idea to its maximum potential. Okay. So that's part of my takeaway out of that story. But cryptography is by no means an ancient science. No means a modern science. It's very much an ancient science, and it's as old as secrets. And ancient Indians were pretty good at cryptography, and they had encryption techniques which they put to really some really good use. Okay. In fact, there used to be, or there was a textbook that even described encryption techniques that was very widely read and very widely used in ancient India. And this textbook is known now all over the world, not just in India, it's known all over the world. Anyone wants to guess what the name of the textbook is? It's a very famous book. I'm very sure most of you have heard of it. It was written, or again, the dates are an iffy thing. It was written somewhere maybe 500 BC or something like that. But some people say it was written more in like 400 AD. But the ideas have been there for a very long time. It was written by a very wise man. He had given up a lot of things except one. Anyone wants to guess? Should I tell you the name of the author? Vatsyayana? Yes, I hear something there. Yes, the name of the book is Kama Sutra. And Kama Sutra has descriptions of cryptography. Okay. If you're wondering why, let me just tell you, fill you in a little of the background, right? As all of you know, we have a goddess of learning, right? Saraswati. She has this wide portfolio, right? Oversees a portfolio of arts, science, music, everything, right? Wisdom. And she has a portfolio of 64 arts, right? What they call Chaushat Kalas, right? In Hindi and Sanskrit, or in Tamil, we call them Aya Kalegal Arivati Nangu, right? Anyone heard of that? Right? Yeah. So, among those 64 arts is cryptography. Okay? And before we go into that list, and these 64 arts were considered very crucial, and people are supposed to get good at them. People in particular, women in particular, even among women, Devadasis in particular, they are expected to be experts on these 64 arts. Okay, as you may know, we had this thing called Devadasi tradition, right? Tradition which was rooted in superstition and exploitation. We had this tradition, and Devadasis were expected to provide, were in the service of God, right? But they saw divinity even in humans. They were also in the service of humans. And they were expected to provide physical, emotional, and intellectual company to people. And the intellectual part required them to be experts on a lot of these arts. Okay. And one of these 64 arts is what was called as Akshara Mushtika Katana. Okay. Akshara, alphabet, right? Letters. Mushtika is your hand, your fingers. Katana is speaking. Okay. It's like speaking letters with your fingers, making gestures, conveying people's thoughts and one's thoughts, feelings, and emotions with your hands. So it is one form of encryption, right? You're encrypting your thought, feeling, and emotion with your hands. Okay. Devadasis are expected to be good at this art, and I also see this as a continuing tradition, especially when you go out on the highways, you see a lorry guy taking over a taxi guy in the wrong way, you see a taxi guy expressing his thoughts, feelings, and emotions with his hands. See it in, as a continuing tradition, but jokes apart, this was one of the arts Devadasis were expected to be good at. The second thing where place where cryptography finds a mention is what is called as Mlechita Kutarka Vikalpa. Okay? Mlechita Kutarka Vikalpa. Mlecha means a foreigner or a barbarian. And Tarka means logic, right? Tarka is logic. Kutarka is the opposite of logic. Something with no logic, no syntax, no grammar. Vikalpa, I think, is an art. So essentially, it's Mlechita Kutarka Vikalpa is conveying your message as if talking without logic and syntax and grammar like a barbarian, okay? Like a foreigner. So it looks scrambled, looks meaningless, but it has a meaning. And Vatsyayana actually describes a method for actually achieving this. And what he says is, and this again was used by Devadasis for writing love letters. So only the person getting the letter can understand the meaning. Okay? And how do they do it? He describes a method for doing it, which is you take all the letters in the alphabet, take each letter and pair it at random, at another letter that has been randomly chosen from the mix. So each letter has a randomly chosen pair. So once you write your letter or a message, you replace each letter in the message with its randomly chosen pair. So unless the person had the mapping, right, which is which, if you read it, it looked all scrambled up, all nonsense, right? It looked like something written illogically, without syntax, without grammar. But the person who has the key will understand it. So this was how Devadasis are expected to maintain the secrecy of the messages, or sending love letters. Okay. And if you think about it, compare, you know, the way I see this, and I also see what Cliff was doing, right? The Westerners, they were using encryption for military purposes, right? Sending messages out to soldiers, whereas the Indians were using encryption for sending love letters, right? So long before, the way I see it, long before the counterculture took over the US, right, in the 60s, and we had slogans, right, like make love, not war, right? Indians are already doing it. They're making love, not war. That probably explains why we kept losing a lot of wars, but that's the way I see it. Okay. So that's one part of the story. And when you move from the past, right, from cryptography in Kama Sutra to the present, so I'll tell you another story. Okay. This time it's a Silicon Valley story. Okay. There are two guys who went to school together in the US, and what they decide to do even when they were studying is try to start up a company as soon as they finish. So they have an idea and they start building up a product. But in typical Silicon Valley fashion, it doesn't really take off. They run into some legal issues, so they had to can this idea. So they shell the product and go back, go their own separate ways. A few years down the road, they come back again. Okay, they come back again and they decide to start up another company and work on another product. Right? This is again typical of startups, right? They start with one idea and keep moving on. The second idea kind of takes off. It's not such a big idea, but it takes off. They have some traction. They start getting some revenues. And as they are doing it, they hit upon another idea which sounds even bigger than the second idea. So they pivot, right? Companies pivot. So they pivot and they start exploring the third idea. And they start using some of the revenue, some of the funds they have raised for the second idea. So they use it for developing the third idea. And what is the third idea they come up with? It is the most audacious idea. What they want to do, they want to replace government when it comes to issuing money. These guys want to issue their own money. They want to issue their own currency instead of the government. They want people using their currency for doing everything, for buying stuff, everything. And they want the currency to be purely digital. They don't want to deal with paper cash, paper money. They don't want to deal with metal coins, nothing. They want the currency to be 100% digital. What does it mean? The money is nothing but a bunch of numbers, bunch of bits sitting in the computer. That's the idea they come up with. They want to come up with their own digital currency system. And they know what exactly it takes to make it work. Because physical money can be stolen from your pockets, right? Pickpockets could take it. Likewise, digital money could be stolen. Could be stolen from the computer. People could hack the computer, take the money out. So they had to figure out how to make that work. And they work and start working on it. And the idea takes off. What is the digital currency? Any idea? What is the company I'm talking about? Bitcoin. Except, very good, very good. Except I'm not talking about Bitcoin. I'm talking about a story in a novel. Cryptonomicon. Anyone read it? It's by Neal Stephenson. It was written way back in 1998. And one of the big plot lines is exactly this digital currency. He talks about it. What takes it work? It's a plot line. Here you have an idea that leaps right off the pages of a novel and becomes a reality today. And he has seen it way back, written about it way back in 1998. The name of the book is Cryptonomicon, okay, if you're interested. by Neil Stevenson. So here you have an idea that jumps off the pages of a book, becomes it's a reality today. There's another idea like that, cyberspace. When have you heard of the term cyberspace, right? Pretty much everybody, right? Cyberspace. You know where it comes from? It comes from a novel by, or a series of stories by William Gibson. He describes the idea of cyberspace in great detail. When did he do it? Early 80s. He could foresee the information revolution that was going to take over. He could see people who are connected to each other through the computers, everyone getting on the same platform, exchanging information, totally, tightly networked. Right? So another idea that jumped off the pages of a book and became a reality. Okay, this again is a crazy thing about ideas. Okay. Now I want to tell you another story. This time it's a real story, not from a novel, not a plot line of a novel. It's a real story. There was this very famous guy, okay, and a very famous person who had made it, okay, and he was approached by some people in the Silicon Valley. Again, it's a startup company based in the Silicon Valley. Some people approached him to promote their product. So since he's a famous guy, he said, hey, you promote our product, and please help us promote our product, and we'll pay you. How do they pay? This is still a very young company. They don't have much cash on hand. So what do they pay? Decided to pay him with stock, equity. And what is the product idea they come up with? It is a service on the internet to let people share images, audio, and video. And they tell this already famous guy, this is the service we want to build, or we are building, and we would like you to help market the product. And this person can very easily market the product. Okay, it was within his ability, but they are not paying him with cash. They want to pay him with equity. Now, should this person, or if you are this famous person, would you take up the offer? Would you take up the offer to promote, which is well within your ability? Yes? That's exactly what this person did. He agreed and he promoted the product in every way he could. And again in 2006, right, it was a very eventful year, YouTube got bought out by Google, right, for $1.65 billion. You want to imagine how much his stock was worth, this famous person's stock was worth? He had a big chunk of stock in the company that he had. Not much, simply because the stock he held was not of YouTube. It was another company that had come up with the idea several years before YouTube. The idea just never took off. They were far ahead of their time. At the time when these guys came up with the video sharing service, internet speeds were very low. Even uploading a passport photo would have taken a long time. And videos, audios, forget it. The company stuttered around for a couple of years, and after that, they just couldn't sustain. They had to close shop. So again, what does it tell me, right, about ideas? Right? YouTube is not a wholly original idea, but they got one thing right. What is that? Timing, exactly. Very good. Okay. So this other crazy thing about ideas. Okay, when people come and talk about, you know, visionary thinking and, you know, thinking far ahead of your time, I think it's all nonsense sometimes. When you read stories like this, being too much of a visionary, too futuristic, really doesn't help ideas because the idea cannot sustain for that long. You just need to be able to think a little beyond the horizon, or maybe even a tried and tested idea that's working, it works. But really true visionaries often don't succeed. Okay, they're just too futuristic. So whenever, now my takeaway is, whenever I hear people talk about visionary thinking, all that, right, I always take it with a pinch of salt, because the crown of, you know, being a visionary gets, you know, put on people's heads after success comes by accident, by a lot of trial and error. Okay. So again, ideas is another place where people get it really, really wrong. You know, high-tech ideas, people, is another place. The good thing is everyone is not right all the time. Even very smart people get things totally, terribly, terribly wrong. Examples, Ken Olson. Ken Olson was the founder of DEC. It's a computer company. It was there in the 70s. And this, which later got, became part of Compaq. And then it later became part of Hewlett-Packard. So it's now part of Hewlett-Packard. And this guy is a visionary pioneer who founded that company. Very successful company. And you know what he said in the 70s, mid-70s? That's when the idea of personal computers, right, PCs, were getting talked about. And what this guy said was, there is no reason why an individual would want to have a computer in their house. That's what he said. And guess what happened, right, from the 80s? He got it terribly, terribly wrong. And another person who got it wrong, right, is, excuse me, Robert Metcalfe. He was one of the pioneers of Ethernet, computer network. He's given credit for coming up with the idea of Ethernet, and he had his own company, 3Com. And he said this in 1995, looking back when we were undergrads here. He said, the internet would catastrophically collapse in 1996. He wrote it in one of his articles, 1995. And he said, if this does not happen, I will eat my words. So he put it on paper. And guess what happened? 1996 was the year internet took off at an exponential rate. Nobody could even imagine, no, the speed at which it took off. But Robert Metcalfe had a good sense of humor. He was pretty embarrassed, but had a good sense of humor. So at one of the conferences, what he did was he printed out, or he brought a copy of his article, put it in a blender, in a mixie, added some juice to it, blended it, and drank it in front of everybody. I'm eating my words. Right. Did that. And another person who got things wrong was another Cliff. He did not become famous for getting things wrong, but he said some pretty funny things, no? Back, no, in the 90s. He said, e-commerce will never take off. People will never want to buy anything on the internet. Okay? One prediction. Another prediction. What do you mean? People will never want to read, or internet will have no impact on how people read newspapers and magazines. Is that the paper newspapers and magazine are the way to go. You know what happened after that, right? A lot of newspapers and magazines had shut down after internet came, and there was a lot of free information and free news. Another thing he said, digital books will never take off. And now, see what, most of you have a digital tablet, right, with which you read books. But this guy didn't become famous for saying these things. He was already very famous for something, and he said these things, and it has been his embarrassment for a lifetime. And who is this person? His name is also Cliff, which is a very different Cliff. And this incident happened, the story happened, what made him famous happened way back in the 80s, the mid 80s. Okay? Cliff was working at the Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, and he was in charge of managing a few computers. Okay, so before I go into the story, let me ask you another question. How much do you think 75 cents matter to you? Or if I convert into Indian rupees, 45 rupees, right? How much does it matter to you? If 45 rupees drops off your wallet, would you really notice it? Or if your mess bill goes up by 45 rupees, how many of you will spend a sleepless night about it? Not much, right? May I ask the faculty here, if your departmental budget, the expense goes up by 45 rupees, would anyone care? Don't care if it's below. So this happened. So happened. This is a story about 75 cents. Okay? Cliff was managing some computers in the Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. And for using computers, people had to pay. It was in the 80s. So people were charged for using the computers, even within the department. Because everyone is given an account, a control account, they had to pay. And his boss noticed that there was an error, there's an accounting issue for amounting to about 75 cents. They were being charged extra for 75 cents. And he asked Cliff to investigate. Anybody else would probably have just forgotten, right? Look at the department, their budget running into hundreds of thousands, if not millions, and the 75 cents extra that has come up. And Cliff goes about looking through, hey, where does this 75 cents come from? And start looking to the computer usage accounts, and he finds out that somebody had used the computers for 9 seconds, okay, and not paid for it. Okay. 9 seconds. How big is 9 seconds, right? Does 9 seconds, is it even perceptible? Right? What can happen in 9 seconds? You can just do a thought experiment, right? I count till 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You think anything big happened in these 9 seconds? Anything big that could have happened in these 9 seconds? Right? As it turned out, as Cliff started digging, somebody had used the computer for 9 seconds. And what he did was try to find out what, and it turned out that somebody was using it unauthorizedly. They are not authorized to use the computer, meaning their computers were getting hacked from outside. And this was the first case of hacking ever recorded in the mid-80s. And Cliff tries to find out, okay, what happened? What is with these 9 seconds? And the answer doesn't come overnight. It takes him 10 months to find out actually what exactly was happening. What was happening was somebody was hacking into the computer, and then he had to figure out from where is it coming. In those times, the calls were made through modems, and he finds out, okay, the call is coming through a modem. And they had 50 different phone lines. And he has to figure out from which phone line this hacker is working through. So he basically attaches 50 terminals to the 50 phone lines and then zooms in on that particular phone line from which the calls are coming through. From there, he finds out, oh, the calls are coming from this phone line and they were coming from some place in Virginia, from a defense contractor. From there, what does he do? He ropes in all the people in the bureaucracy, the CBI, CIA, the FBI, right, NSA, and nobody had ever dealt with a hacker. Nobody had ever dealt with hacking. So he had to convince them something is happening and make the bureaucracy work and try to figure out what is happening. One option was to just shut the lines down to the hacker, but they decided not to do that. They just want to trace what this person is doing and try to track him down. And what they did, this happened in the 80s, and what they do is they set up a teleprinter to that phone line and log in all the keystrokes of the hacker. So they track all his activities. And when they do that, they find out this guy has been using their computer to hack into a lot of other defense databases and stealing a lot of sensitive information. And the key search they were using was like nuclear, you know, SDI, I think Strategic Defense Initiatives, things like that. Taking all, copying all the files out. And he was doing all kinds of things that you hear about today, right? He was doing copying password files and launching dictionary attacks. And he was also setting up, you know, Trojan horses to get people's passwords. He was doing all kinds of funny things. So what do these guys do? They then figure out, track the phone lines, figure out the calls are coming at a certain time of day. But as it turns out, when you use computers, the phone charges will vary depending on the time of day. Usually, if you're working from outside, you try to make calls only at the night because it's cheaper. But this guy is making calls during the day. So what they try to do is figure out, why is he making calls during the day? It means it's night for him. Then they track the time zone, and it shows them the calls are coming from Germany across, not even in the US. Then they get the German authorities involved and set up what is called, now we call honeypot, right? If you want to catch a hacker, you set up a honeypot. It's like, you know, trying to catch bear or monkeys in the forest. You keep a honeypot, let them come and catch. So they developed this technique called, they didn't call it honeypot at that time, but now it's called honeypot. So they invent a whole new department in the organization called SDI, Strategic Defense Initiatives. They create a whole new server just for the department. They load it up with a lot of nonsense, right? What's sounding like different sounding documents, and wait for this guy to come, hunt it down. And when he comes and hunt it down, they track him down. Where exactly it was coming from. It was coming from a university in Germany. And then they go in and get him arrested and try him. And this was the first case of hacking. I remember reading this story. Cliff, the name of the person who did this was Cliff Stahl, Clifford Stahl. I remember reading the story back when I was here in the 90s. You know, he wrote a book about it. It's called The Cuckoo's Egg. And it's a cult classic. Anyone interested in this area should read that book. you know, it is a story that stayed with me for a very, very long time. You know, 20 plus years, I still remember the story. Because I really thrilled reading it, all these fancy things happening. Okay, and the reason they were able to do all this was their attention to detail, detail at the level of the second decimal place, at the level of 9 seconds, right? You look at computer time, it's running into several, several hours and days. And 9 seconds is not even a fraction of several days. But this is what actually helped them track this guy down. And this sort of also gives me a segue into my, we're nearing the end, to my own story, the Steradian Trail. This kind of attention to detail, you know, looking at things beyond the second decimal point is by no means a modern thing. And it's by no means uniquely American or European or anything. You know. The ancient Indians were pretty good at this stuff, doing things with great precision, great exactness. And that was particularly true when you think about religion, doing rites and rituals. You'd be amazed by the extent to which they went in making sure things were done as per the rules laid out to them. So Indians were a very ritualistic society, right? We still are a ritualistic society, but what you see today is only a very tiny fraction of how things used to be 3,000 years ago. Okay, and what people did as part of rituals in general, they make offerings into the fire, right? For a variety of reasons. And you offer different things at different times, but what they did for most of the time as part of rituals was make offerings into the fire. And they had ISO-like specifications on how exactly to do it. And they had specifications on how exactly the sacrificial ground had to be built. And they had specifications on how exactly the fire altar had to be built. Right? Fire altar or Havan Kund or Homagundam, as you call it, right? They had methods to build those things. And there you can imagine, you know, the altars look this big, probably this big, even bigger, some of them are even bigger. And these altars had to conform to certain specifications, certain dimensions, shapes and forms. And the accuracy was measured as a fraction of the size of a sesame seed. Okay? Can you imagine that? It's big. Sesame seed, you know, right? It's a fraction, tila, right? As a fraction, what fraction? 1,000th of the width of a sesame seed. That is how accurate the construction of the fire altars had to be. That was the requirement. And Indians were a very ritualistic society, very God-fearing, very superstitious, right? And they went about to ensure that level of accuracy. Because it's the same superstition, same God-fearing nature that led to the development of mathematical techniques that helped them achieve that level of accuracy. Know what techniques I'm talking about? Syllabus sutras. Okay. Kama Sutra talks about cryptography. Syllabus Sutra has numerical algorithms. And this is one of the themes I deal with in my book, The Steradian Trail. And the Steradian Trail is a curtain raiser of a larger series. It is called the Infinity Cycle, and Steradian Trail is the book number 0 of the Infinity Cycle, right? Book 0 of the Infinity Cycle, 0 and infinity. You cannot talk about one without the other. The two ideas are related, so we decided to go for this subtitle. And it's a mystery thriller. It talks about science, it talks about superstition, and all of that is underpinned by crime. So it's a mystery thriller where you find a variety of topics like science, religion, culture, computers, technology, crime, all of them as part of the same narrative. And it is all done not in a very dense or heavy way, but in a very lighthearted way, with a sense of humor and with a breezy writing style. And it is also a book of ideas. And it is also a book of ideas and also shows the one thing I talked about, right? The time and place, how the same idea could take different forms depending on the time and place. The same idea in one place at one time could be used for something in one place at one time, could be used for something drastically different at another place at another time. Some of the themes I tackle with. And I would like to say more, but it would spoil the reading of people who have not yet read the book. So I think I will end my talk on this note. Okay, and we have some copies of the book available in case you are interested. So do take a look, read the book. I'm available online at mnkrish.com. So if you want to give me feedback, I'm really very happy to hear what you think of the book. It can be emailed through mnkrish.com. And if you have any questions, comments on this talk, we can, I think, talk about them over the Q&A. And with that, I would like to end this talk. Thank you so much for your attention.
Hi. Can you hear me?
No, not really, but I can walk down. Okay, I started writing, so the thing is the ideas, I've been toying with these ideas for a very long time, back when I was a student, but I didn't do much about it, and I started writing about 12 years ago on the series, so took me a very, very long time, this is not one book. I was working for 12 years, but not on one book, but on this entire series. So I wrote about 3 books in the series over a 12-year period. So. Does that answer your question? I had this idea of like the connections between, you know, and say I, for one, I am a story seeker. I'm more than a story, more story seeker than a storyteller. And I see these connections between science and religion and then culture and crime. So one of the things, the time and place, right, that I talked about, it's one of the ideas that intrigues me. The same thing could take different shapes and forms depending on the time and depending on the place. The same ideas. So that's one of the things I found. And I wanted to basically explore that further. And there is, again, you always hear about the conflict between religion and science, right? But at the same time, they also see a collaboration between religion and science, how religion was instrumental in the development of science, particularly true in the case of India, and also true, I think, in European sense. Some of the developments in physics came out of the interest to learn the creation of God, to understand the creation of God. So I was interested in things like that, you know, connection between science, religion, crime, computers. You know, maybe there are no connections, I see connections, but I saw these connections. And I saw a lot of stories in there that have not been told, that are not being told by other people. And I thought maybe I should give it a try. But I didn't know what I was getting myself into. So I wrote the first draft, very, very terrible. And then I expanded that into a series. So I kept writing, rewriting this about 8-9 times. This book went through 8 or 9 drafts, but I was also working on 2 other books. So at one time, I had like 3 different manuscripts that I was fooling around with. And 12 years is a very long time. So that's how it came to be.
So did you write when you were a student? No,
I didn't write when I was a student. I wrote it when I was working.
Did you generally write?
Not really, no, actually. I have been reading more, you know, to be very honest, here IIT is a place where I actually started reading stuff in English. You know, until then I had not read anything in English. Is where I started reading, and the Cliff Stahl story, Cuckoo's Egg, I remember it's one of the first stories I had actually read. I was lucky to read a story like that, which got me interested in reading further. You know, right? So I was more interested in reading, but I got interested in writing, I think, a little later. But it's one of the things I wanted to do, but I had to get good at it before I can do it, right? So it took me a while.